And there is 26 vocational schools and Ministry of Education and Research members of these consortiums. And what is important, all our activities, it doesn't mean that we don't provide activities for the schools who are not a member of our consortium. We do the activities, trainings and so forth, we do for all the vocational schools. But there are schools who want to be part of the consortium, who want to address the importance of digital learning development within school. This is kind of acknowledging that we are acting under the same aim, same goal. And to put in very short, we support the development of digital learning, as I already explained. Main activities I talk today. So I understood there is special interest on how we support assessment of digital capability in vocational schools, training programs for teachers and school leaders, assessment of teachers and learners' digital competences, and we also deal with implementing principles for creating digital learning materials. We cover all these topics. We also coordinate network of educational technologists, which is actually a very independent network already, so they don't really need us anymore. And we have a lot of programs to support all these activities. The quite new thing what we do right now is model to assess and monitor digital capability. So we adapted a model from general education to vocational education. This model is for vocational schools themselves to assess their digital capability. This model has three different topics, as you can see here: pedagogical innovation, change management, and digital infrastructure. And under these three topics, there are five different measurements. As you can see, I put down some examples. In pedagogical innovation, for example, these five measurements are about learning environments, resources, and roles. And in change management, we talk about whole school policies, learning organization, how to develop it. And in digital infrastructure, the main interesting question is about bring your own device, principles, Wi-Fi support, and so forth. So in this model, in all those five competencies, we schools assess themselves on five different scale model, 5-point assessment scale to assess these requirements. And what is important that we actually aimed to put the A is the lowest level and the E is the highest level, and we put down the highest level. How to say, it's kind of unreachable in some cases, but it is done intentionally. So when we talk about innovation, we have to aim a bit higher. So if to explain this, exchange level means that the use is episodic in school. In some parts we use digital devices, digital learning, and so forth. When we talk about the enriched level, this means that within the school we already exchange experience. On enhanced level, it means that the changing learning process is going wider. So we are redesigning on whole school level. Extending means that we put more emphasis on permanent innovation. And empower means that we go beyond our organization. So we are kind of flagship in our region in this field. And there is no aim for, there is no red line where everybody has to get to. So, because it's a self-assessment model, and schools themselves, they assess on those topics, on those measurements, what are their aims, and where they want to go. So what are the aims for the next 2 years, for example. And then if we do this kind of self-assessment, it means that we can't do it on paper. There has to be online environment. So Tallinn University experts came to help, and we made this kind of cooperation contract. So they gave us the system. They designed and developed the online environment for free, and we gave them users, so they can get the research over this data they collect through this environment. So this is from this environment. I can't actually show you the environment because I would be showing the school's personal data, and actually they have to permit to show all the information. So this is one school example of this from this environment where you can see. How to explain? So you can see, it would be easy to show something, but you can see here that. Sellega. Here is a digital innovation. This is change management, and this is digital infrastructure. And this is not very usual, actually, circle. Here you can see on the colors what are the self-assessment, and on the dots you can see what are the aims for next 2 years. So, as I said, there is very important to stay on that level also. It doesn't mean that you have to aim for the fifth level on all measurements. But usually we got these kind of circles where we had this kind of cake where digital innovation was cut off. So we had very good levels of self-assessment on change management and on digital infrastructure. But this part, we don't know why, it didn't come forward. So it was lower on self-assessment. Here you can see digital infrastructure, very good level. So all the schools, they get this kind of graphic. This gives a very good overview. Where are we now and where we want to go? Does it, I go a little bit. Let me know if I go too far from the answer. So what is important, is that all the schools create their own digital plans, so they plan the activities, how to reach this level, what they have are aiming for. And they themselves decide what are the deadlines, for example, is it 2 years, 5 years? The environment also supports, I have to first explain that they do self-assessment. It means that usually education and technologists who is working in school refills the model and gives the evidence for these levels he or she thinks that the school have, and then they form digital working group which assesses also, and changes maybe some levels of assessment. And then after that, if school wants to, there is possibility to maybe get together with other school, some other school, find a partner and assess themselves from outside. But it's not, as I said, the system is not obligatory. Schools can themselves decide if they want to use it or they don't want to use it. This gives a very good framework to discuss in school. What are we aiming for? So we don't just act randomly. And we decide on policies, on aims for the next step, for example. And just to illustrate a little bit, here you can see the smaller circle, the blue one, is actually the self-assessment, how to say, arithmetic mean, yeah, and from 20 schools. And the wider circle are the aims of schools have to. So the mainly they want to, where they want to have a change is here. This is teacher and learner role changing. And also here, digital devices, they need more. So here you can see how they want to widen their level in digital learning. What we have learned so far about this model and about this kind of online environment we call digital neuro is that it works, but it took time to adopt. What we saw, what was very good examples, that we saw that schools started to discuss what these terms mean. What we mean about digital learning, digital devices, what are our principles, what is new learning. So you can see that the thoughts came out. It was very good incentive to discuss schools, all these things, but in the model. Because we gave a quite open room for the schools. We didn't actually say that we think that it means this. School can themselves use this tool as they see fit. And what was the key was teamwork, of course, and school principal must be involved. So things go smoothly. For educational technologies, as I already mentioned, this gave a more strategic overview. So teachers usually didn't get what the educational technologist was talking about. So she can morally, strategically explain what is required and what we need to go. And the very good incentive also was that schools are overwhelmed by the service provided outside, where you get no feedback. What is happening with the data they put in. So in this way, schools themselves use the data and work with this format. And we also, there is in this system, we have a school owner's view also. There is a public view, so you can publish your digital plan to show others if you want to. It's not obligatory. This is a quite new approach. So you give the kind of organizational view for this digital term. So far we talked, we train, we do different things, but this is kind of giving the responsibility for the school to decide. And of course there was actually at first a big discussion, they wanted to look good. So they self-assessed themselves very well, and then this realized that keeping this level is very hard. So what we do is train trainers and do trainings for teachers. So this is a very big part of Innovation Center. We create new materials for these trainings, and we have a whole concept around it. So to get an idea, here are the numbers for the teachers in Estonia. Estonia is a very small country, as you know. But every year we have around 4,000 teachers and lecturers participating in our training programs. And what is important, it's actually usually the number goes vocational teachers, there are 7 to 8% of the learners. The teachers who learn in our training program, 7 to 8%. And this is quite normal because vocational teachers are 7 or 8% from the whole teachers number. So it's a quite good number as expected. Here are some topics what we teach. And of course, the technology-based learning is very important place. As you see, as you know, the programming story is from Estonia, so we have a Progetiger program under where we do a lot of these kind of trainings. But of course, mainly we teach learning process in the digital age, and e-safety is very important topic also. Right now we have a lot of discussion about this bring your own device, because a lot of people talk about the safety issues through this. Very shortly about the main training programs. Why I talk about the training programs, because I want to talk about the digital competences for the teachers, so you can get the idea. They are very strongly linked to our training programs. We have a Digital Start, which is for the kindergarten teachers. For the vocational schools, the main program is the Teacher of Future, and the school leaders at the digital age. We have very good, very lot of schools from vocational schools have participated this school leaders program, which is very good. And of course the Progetiger program. And to get an idea of how we do the trainings, we mainly do blended courses. 25% is open and 75% is in-house training. And all the trainings are free in case you graduate, which means that we make a kind of agreement between teachers that if you come, you have to finish. And if we well, we only have to send out maybe 5 invoices in a year. And we are very, we're blended and we are very flexible, so we find the way for teachers to finish, because in vocational education the time is essence, because the teachers don't have so much time to come our training, so we find the time and each teacher, if they have a problem to finish, we do this kind of separate timeline for them, so we find the way to, and support their graduation. And we have an online system, of course, to organize and to keep track of your trainings. This means that every teacher can log in, see all the certificates, see the trainings that have registered, and so on. So this is all done via online system. We don't send out any certificates on paper. And if we talk about digital competences. Of course, we have created a digital competency model based on TCOMP for learners. But for teachers, we have used ISTENET's standard. Have you heard about ISTENET? This is an international society for technology and education. And based on that standard, we have adopted Estonian version. And all our trainings are connected to the competences. So when you choose a training, you get an idea of what competences you will cover in this model. And we also have an online system for following and how to say, putting down the path. You assess, you put down your ideas where you are, where you want to go. But the online system is not needs a lot of development, because it doesn't give a lot of feedback right now. It's kind of just mapping system for your competencies. We have online system for that too, but yeah, it needs development. But if we talk about teacher competencies, we have 5 main categories based on this adopted model. And it covers the whole area, of course. So the teacher's professional development, how to deal with students, what does it mean in digital age, how we learn, what has changed in learning and so on. So these five topics, they cover almost everything. And to give an example, in our model, what we created under this first topic, for example, we give the explanation for the teacher, what does it mean, this theme, and then under this theme, you have five under first competency. So this is example how to explain. This is the first competence under first category. And there are four competencies under each these five categories. So we give explanation and description. Description is actually longer. And then we give teacher the scale to assess. So we had a five level of assessment. It was too difficult for teachers. They say that they just couldn't read all this, couldn't decide where was the right level. So we simplified it. After we did a research, we simplified the model, and now we have this, actually this free level of assessment, but the first one is non-user. And we went further in this digital model that if teachers want to assess themselves, we don't talk about not using anymore. So I know the digital tool, for example. I know I have heard about it. This level we don't talk about anymore. We talk about using. Are you using? This is the first level. So because there is always so wide possibility to say that I have heard about this. So the and how do we if we talk about the trainings, then how do we know that they have covered these competencies after the course? What we do in our training program is that we divide it into two parts. It means that they have to actually go back to school and implement some tool. They get the assignment to implement these topics, these devices they have learned, and then they can come back and reflect on that assignment, and then they graduate the training. So that is why it is blended, because online course it goes to abstract, and it needs to have face-to-face meetings, and it needs to have an implementation in between, so we can be assured that they have actually tried it in their with their teacher, with their students, and in their classroom. This is our aim. And of course, the digital competencies has to be there in this model, because otherwise we just talk about different things and there is no structure for the trainings and for the teachers also to put their aims in place. So, actually the digital competencies and this assessment model for the organization was the main things I wanted to talk about today. But also what we do is the digital resources. We have supported over the years creation of digital resources, especially in vocational education. Right now we mainly provide recommendations for creating digital learning materials, because this creation of learning materials in this period is over. Now we just let the schools themselves, we don't support with any program, digital learning resources. We just cover the main topics, so what they have to be aware of if they create learning materials. So we provide them these kind of recommendations and guidelines, and of course HITSA is also representative of Creative Commons in Estonia, so we also want all the resources to have a proper license, properly licensed. Of course, we have had repositories for the learning materials. Right now, we are changing it again. because the time changes very quickly, so we are having a new system set up right now. It's called e-schoolback. We cover educational technologies network. Actually, network is our success. So we use a lot of experts, a lot of educational technologies. They are actually the people who are helping us to understand what has to be done in schools. They have their annual summer school, mailing list, Skype group. There are over 100 people in that network. And they actually don't need us anymore, but we need them. So they are working very well in schools. We need them to give us some input and understanding what is happening in the school. And finally, for the programs. So we do a lot of different programs. Maybe some programs that are maybe interests you. I talk about three today. So the ProGetIGA program, this year it's not focused on vocational education. But last 2 years, it was also focused on vocational education too. It depends on how ministry decides what are the aims for the next year. And mainly what we do, we cover digital learning resources, competitions for students, we talk about programming, we talk about robotics, those we have different trainings, we support digital infrastructure and so on. So it's and there is also a network of teachers there. So this is quite this kind of common development project. Then eTwinning, we also are an eTwinning organization, and we really would like that vocational education would be more involved, because it's very common in general education, but vocational schools doesn't want to participate as much. But it is actually for vocational schools also, and some people don't know. And we have had this year some cool projects. You can ask Katrin. Katrin also did one cool project this year. And we have a Smartly on the Web project. So beside all these activities, we always have the e-safety issues on the side. So we have to talk about the protection, sharing your information, and so forth. So we are a member of the Better Internet for Kids community and participating in all these international operations to bring it to Estonia. So unfortunately, everything is in Estonia with us. So all the systems, I only can give you a link to our English website, but all the systems, all the models, everything is in Estonian, so I don't have any lot of links to give you. But if you have any questions, then of course I am happy to ask, answer. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for your great explanation. I have two short questions, and the first question is it's really inspiring, it's motivating. Are schools free to join your programs? Is it elective, or are they are the programs compulsory?
No. The participation consortium is free. Initially we had a consortium fee, but for 2 or 3 years we doesn't have it anymore, and it is not obligatory. And if you are not in a consortium, it doesn't mean that you can't participate in the trainings, for example. It's free for all the teachers.
Okay, thank you. What I see is that so many schools and teachers are joining your programs. What makes that they are so motivated? Because in the Netherlands, for example, I see that digital skills, digital competences for teachers feels always as something extra to do.
Actually, the digital competences are part of the teacher's qualification standard. So maybe this motivates them. But of course, Estonia is a sea country, and our trainings are very popular. I actually don't know what are the main incentives behind it, but we have very good network. Maybe that is why, because we train the trainers, they are in the regions, it's in-house training, so it's easy for them to participate, actually. But of course, we have had these kind of problems that they, in these trainings, you have to do a lot of work. It's not a seminar that you come and you listen and you go home. You have to do a lot of homework. But maybe the qualification gives them some ideas. And of course, we can see that some teachers, they want to be part of our networks. It's interesting things, interesting people in these networks. They go to trainings, they see each other at different events. So it's Estonia, a small country. That is why it is very easy. You see your friends in your trainings.
Thank you very much.
I have one question. Because actually, I mean, I come from the university, so for me it seems that the weakest link in implementing all those new solutions is actually a lecturer or teacher. And there seems to be a very good network for educational technologists. But how do you see it? Is there room for enhancing the link between the educational technologists and the teachers who actually go to classrooms and interact with the students?
The success actually is that you have an educational technologist in your school. So education technologist is the one who is talking to the teachers. When we provide trainings, then we sometimes contact the educational technologist and say, your school haven't participated in our trainings. Maybe we do a separate group for you. And they talk to their teachers in school that they should come to trainings and so on. Because education technologist, him or herself, wants teachers to get better because this is his or her job. So this kind of networking is the key. Actually, the link is there because the education technologist is very good to bring the teachers together. So we have very good examples of how educational technologists work in school. It means that how they do this kind of workshop. They put their some kind of name, which very well, gives a good message for the teachers, and then in between she or he talks about the digital devices. So they do this kind of tricks in schools to get them on board, to get them interested. And if we support education technologists, then we can be sure that they are doing a very good job in school.
So thank you for your extensive overview.